Praise be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has bestowed on us in Christ every spiritual blessing in the heavens. God chose us in him before the world began to be holy and blameless in his sight, to be full of love. He likewise predestined us through Christ Jesus to be his adopted sons. Such was his will and pleasure, that all might praise the glorious favor he has bestowed on us in his beloved. Well, I want to welcome you to our, thank you. Please stop dropping in dramatic. Okay, I want to welcome you to this retreat, and I'm just delighted that you chose as your theme St. John of the Cross. I'm sure that if you saw that video, I guess you got a little idea of his life. Now, he is interested in one reality, and that reality is contemplation. He has written four major books, and each one of those books are about the experience of contemplation. And what John of the Cross has added to the mystical tradition of the church is a very clear and precise understanding of what contemplation is. Certainly our fathers, following Origen and the early fathers of the church, they talk about contemplation, and especially William of St. Thierry, he talks about the joys of contemplation. But what precisely is contemplation? Well, I think it's John of the Cross who has given us the clearest definition of what contemplation is. Contemplation is an experience of Almighty God. It is God coming into the soul of a person and giving them an experience of that reality. Now, God is a pure spirit, and our souls are pure spirit. So therefore, to have this experience of soul and soul, we have to quiet the other parts of our being. Now, by our being, I'm talking about our mind and our spirit. John of the Cross is definitely an educated man. He went through a good education, and there was a great emphasis on philosophy, and especially Aristotelian philosophy. So he uses terms that Aristotle uses in defining the mind, the activity of the mind, the activity of the spirit. And that activity is our thinking. The mind can think and know and can will. It can make decisions. It's all part of what's going on up here in our brain. And the scientists today have done a great deal of work with the brain. They know exactly what part of the brain particular things are happening. For instance, when we're working on a project, it knows where our imagination is stored, where our function is stored when we are in a project. they can wire people up, and they know just what part of the brain lights up and starts working while we're thinking abstractly and we're thinking concretely. They know what part of the brain is when we make a decision, that we all the functionings that are part of our, you might say our mental activity, is all known now today by the scientists. And way, way, way back then, John of the Cross, he knew a great deal about what our brain is doing, and of course this all comes from Aristotelian philosophy. We have a body that has a mind, a physical mind, with all its neurons and synapses. And we have a spirit where we have the talk about our intellect and will in our spirit. And then we have a soul. And it is in the soul that the Blessed Trinity dwells. It is in the soul that Jesus has come and made up his abode with us. And so this experience of contemplation takes place in our soul, in that spiritual part of our being. Spirit and spirit are united and joined, and they can have an experience of that, we can have an experience of that reality. Now, John of the Cross tells us what is a hindrance to this experience of soul and soul. The main disturbance, you might say, of this soul and soul, St. John of the Cross talks about desire. The desire for things, the desire that that come up in our life for things, a desire for a reputation, a desire for possessions, desire for, you can say, ambition. So he sees that desire is one of the major problems for us arriving at this experience of contemplation, this experience of soul and soul. And so therefore he has this whole, he has this book, Ascent of Mount Carmel. The major part of that book is about desire and how desire can cripple the activity of our soul because it is so weighty. And it doesn't make any difference. Now he's talking mainly to monks and nuns. He's directing his books to Carmelite nuns and monks. So he's saying to them that it doesn't make any difference if you don't have anything. You're in your monasteries and you certainly don't have many possessions, but if you desire, if you are filled with desires, then it's just as bad as if you had the object of your desire. It weighs you down. Now, if you have looked at St. John of the Cross's writings, you'll see that he makes a lot of comparisons. He loves to use metaphors and similes, and he's constantly saying, this is like this. So he says a desire, and it doesn't make any difference whether desire is a big thing or a little thing. No matter what it is, it's going to hold you down. And he says that that this is like a bird. A bird can be held down by a rope around its foot or a thread. So no matter how big it is, it can hold you down and captivate you. and make it impossible for you to reach this reality of your soul, the part of you that is spirit. So, most of the Mount Carmel is about this desire for things. And then he talks about the memory of things. Not only are we held down by desire, but also memory. We know that there's a part of the brain that stores up everything that we have experienced and everything that that we have perceived. It's all stored up here in our memory. And if you spend all your time in your memory, you're not going to arrive at this part of your being that is pure spirit, because the memory can really bog you down. And when you think of it, think of your memory. You want to remember all the stuff that you did when you were a kid. Then we want to remember all the stuff that you had when you were an adolescent, and then through your education, and then through your jobs. And you can spend all your time remembering all this stuff that happened in your life. Now, it is very, very sad when people spend a lot of time in the memory of their failures and their sins, because that can really, really weigh you down and make you very, very sad when you think about all your failings and all the sins that you've had in your life. So it's good not to spend all your time in this memory, because it can be very, very heavy. And you can spend a great deal of time really making yourself sad by remembering past failures and not realizing that the mercy of God has forgiven those past failures as soon as you have turned to Him and let Him know that you really are sorry for that. The divine mercy has really swallowed up all your failures of the past. So all those sad memories that are way back there that can make you so sad, so really miserable, don't let yourself dwell on them. They are past. And this is where the notion of living in the present, not living in memories. Your memories can really hold you down, so that it's difficult for you to get to this point of spirit. And so he says that it's much better for a baby to just be at his mother's breast and just be very, very quiet and just take that milk. But if the baby is fighting and kicking the mother and moving its hands around, is agitated and is really, really busy, you might say, trying to get the milk, it's not going to get much milk. The best way is to just be there and be very, very quiet without a lot of activity and just quietly take the milk. Another image he has is of the lake. If the lake just is perfectly still, it will be absorbed up into the clouds and the atmosphere, rather than being all stirred up. It can go up much faster if it's just perfectly quiet. So what he is saying is that when the soul is quiet, when it is free from desires, instead of being overwhelmed with desire and wanting what it does not have, and spending all its time in this area of its life, then it won't get to the spirit, to the experience of God within it. Now, in prayer progresses in a man's life, we start with a conversation with God, and then we eventually come to a meditation where we're thinking of the life of Jesus and spending our time in meditation. And then he talks about after meditation, after you have spent a good deal of time studying the life of our Lord and studying the mysteries of the church and all that we have been taught, there is a grace from God that makes it impossible for us to meditate. Meditation is using the brain. It is using your imagination. It's using your memory. It's using your, certainly not your desires, but real activity in your intellect. And God, if he wishes to give you this gift of coming to your spirit, he can, you might say, make it impossible for you to meditate. You just can't do it. You can't concentrate. You can't think of a particular part of our Lord's life or an event in the scriptures. It just doesn't work. Now, St. Teresa of Avila has a word that she uses. Your faculties are, there is a ligature of your faculties. They are tied up, which is what the word ligature means. She's very descriptive, and you can just see your brain up here having a string around it and being tied up so that it doesn't work. You can't think. And when you get to this stage of not being able to think and meditate, then John of the Cross says, this is one of the signs that you are called to contemplation if you cannot meditate. But you are perfectly happy to be very quiet. You're just sitting quietly, and you can do that, you can be quiet, but then you feel enjoyment in this being quiet. You're in church, but before the Blessed Sacrament, and you first get to church, and you're all upset about things, and your mind is very, very active, and so you say, well, I'm going to meditate for a little while, but you can't meditate. But after a while, your mind sort of quiets down, and you're very happy just to sit there. And St. John of the Cross says that that's one of the signs that God is going to give you the gift of contemplation, the gift where you are spirit and spirit. And so after after some period of time, this becomes habitual, that when you go to church, you like to sit there, and you're content you can't meditate because you've got this what John of the Cross would call the dark night, and St. Teresa would call the ligature of the faculties. You can't do anything with them. They're just not functioning, and so therefore you are happy and content to just be quiet. And then the third sign is that this contentment with being quiet becomes habitual. It's every time that you go to church now, you want to get to that point where you are content to just be there. Now, what is happening to you is that you are climbing the ascent of Mount Carmel. St. John of the Cross has drawn a picture, a diagram of a mountain, and that's Mount Carmel. And up the center of this mountain, he has this road, two lines going up the center. And in the center of that, those two lines are the words nada, nada, nada. No thing, no thing, no thing. Now, God is no thing. Our souls are no thing. And so the way to for our soul to be united with God is through nothing. No thing, no thing, no thing. No working of the mind, no working of the desires, no working of the memory. It's really and truly an experience of nada, nada, nada. We get to this contemplation through no thing, because this contemplation is no thing. It is union with God and an absence of all other things. It's an absence of desire. It's an absence of memory. It's an absence of concepts. It's an absence of any thinking faculty that we have. So therefore, you might say that to experience this no thing, it has to happen, you might say, for a very short period of time, where it is pure no thing. Because our minds and are always, they always seem to be thinking or doing or desiring, or like we always seem to be thinking something or having concepts or ideas. Yet we're saying now that this union with God is no thing, so therefore it cannot last very long. In fact, it can be in the first touches of this contemplation very, very short, and we only know it's happened to us in hindsight. It's only after it has happened where we're in this union with God for a moment. And here we are after the fact, knowing that we did have a moment, and maybe we don't even know that we had a moment of absolute silence within our souls. And in that silence, in that moment, we were united with God. He, you might say, chose us before the world began, before we came into being. He chose us to be his adopted sons. Now, to be a son means to be a relative. It means that you're the same reality as he is, which is soul and soul, or spirit and spirit. The reality, the divine reality of who God is, so that you are an adopted son of his, and you are one with him in that moment. Can that moment become habitual? Well, John of the Cross says yes, and that's what that's really and truly what he's talking about. He's talking about a contemplative lifestyle where your prayer is predominantly this experience of spirit and spirit. It is a vocation to be called to this, you might say, this type of prayer, which is beyond meditation, which is beyond any activity of the mind, beyond any activity of the soul, but as pure spirit. And what is the value of this being pure spirit? Well, the value of it is what St. Paul says in this chapter in Ephesians, to be a praise of his glory. In some way, at this moment, a human being is in union with God, soul and soul, on this planet. And that has tremendous value for the individual, for the community, for the church. Because Jesus came to bring the divine here. And now, you might say, it's being totally realized. It's being realized in the fact that we now are adopted sons and daughters. We are in union with the reality of who God is, which is pure spirit. God is dwelling in you, and you are his son. You are within his being, the essence of God. And this is a foretaste, according to St. John of the Cross, of paradise. This is what happens in paradise. We will be soul and soul with God. We will be totally united with him in his divinity. The reality of who he is, which is the reality of divinity. And this is the goal, putting St. John of the Cross, of life here on this planet. And to be, we are all called by God, we are all chosen by God for this reality. This is where we're going to, you might say, end up in heaven. Can we have a foretaste of that before we get there? Yes. And it's when we are, you might say, free from the things that hold us back from being nada, from being this reality of what our spirit is. Our spirit is pure breath of God, and it was given to us at our conception, this breath of God, and it's there within us. Can we come in contact with it? Now, of course, contemplation is not a reward for being holy or being good. John of the Cross is not teaching that you have to have all these virtues and all this goodness. Now, certainly the virtues and the goodness comes with, you might say, the package. When God is bringing you to this reality of prayer, of contemplation, he's also giving you the virtues. But they're all being given to you by him. Now, you cooperate with this activity of God, but that cooperation is a gift from him. So that you have to say, as St. Teresa of Lisieux said, tout la grâce, it is all grace, so that this journey of nada, 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 up the mountain, is completely done by God. He completely surrounds us, surrounds our activities, surrounds everything that we do with his divine grace. So that it is arriving at this contemplation, which is no thing, it's absolute silence, its absolute moment of silence. And that's the value of what we have quiet in the monastery. It's very, very interesting that all the places that we have silence in the monastery, the church, the cloisters, the library, the refectory, wherever the community is, we have to observe silence, because we never know what graces the other one is receiving at this particular moment. And it could be that it's this particular moment when God is touching this particular person with this moment of union with him in the nada, the nothingness that is contemplation is touching this particular person. Well, it could be in church, it could be when he's walking down the cloister, it could be in the library, the refectory. And then whenever the community is together, there is silence, because we never know who could be praying at that moment. And when we use the word praying, we are referring to this praying contemplation, because this is really, I mean, the whole purpose of this monastery is to foster and to make it easy and possible for the members of the community to experience this contemplation, which is no thing. And to get there, there has to be silence. And so your joining in with us, in some way, God has given you a vision, an idea, understanding of what this prayer is, so that's why you want to be connected with us, because we are a contemplative monastery, and that is our charism. Because it is, and it's very interesting that the Vatican Council says that no matter how pressing the needs of the church are, they are not to take the monks out of their monasteries. They are to leave them there for their contemplation, because the fathers of the church see the value of this contemplation. That we can be here specializing in this reality of nada, of nothing. Because it sees that that nothing is the way that we can touch God, because he is nothing. He is no created thing. Now, you will say, well, Jesus is a created thing. Well, yes, he is. He came here and he took on our created bodies. He had a mind. He had a spirit. And he had a soul, all human. And he, while he was here, he went off frequently, went off to be away from everything that was material, and did his own prayer. Now we can only imagine what Jesus' prayer was. Jesus, who now is an incarnate image of Almighty God, and so therefore, his, you might say, his other half, his divine half, had to bring his human half into relationship with that other half, that divinity. And I believe that is what happened when he went off to the desert to pray and to get away from all that is, from all the material things of this world, and to be at that nada, nada, nada. So if Jesus was there, he is inviting us to be there, to be in that desert for that moment when we can experience nothing. But as I say, it has to be in hindsight. We don't know that we had the experience, because if we had the experience, we would have had something. There's something there that we're not having the experience. So therefore, we can only know it in hindsight. In hindsight, you know that God has touched you, and you know it by, you might say, the fervor. It is an experience primarily of love, and that's a big point of John of the Cross. It is an experience of love. In some way, God has touched you and showing you how much he loves you. And part of that love is divine mercy. He loves you, and he loves you as he has made you. And that's why it is so sublime. And John of the Cross, of course, if there's any word to describe him, is that he is describing the sublime. That man has touched the sublime, and his poetry is sublime, and his writing is sublime. He's filled with the beauty of this experience, and you can't miss that. It's there in his writing. He is totally absorbed in this experience of God. And that's you might say, it's the only thing that is really on his mind is contemplation. The experience of God in his own spirit. And he wants to share that with these nuns, with these Carmelites, and with these Carmelite friars. And he, yes, and I think he does a marvelous job. He has four writings: The Ascent of Mount Carmel, The Dark Night of the Soul, and The Spiritual Canticle, and The Living Flame of Love. Now you can see those four books as a progression. The Ascent of Mount Carmel, he's primarily trying to tell us to get rid of desires and to put our memories at peace. Then the Spiritual Canticle is about the experience of the joy, the love that he experienced in this union with God. Then the Spiritual Canticle is going further than that, and it's a love story. It's just filled with this tremendous love of God. And fourthly, The Living Flame is exactly what that is. He's just describing this experience as a living flame. It's just absolute bursting with ecstatic love of God. So his writing is a treasure that we have, and it truly is our mystical heritage. Many people went off to India during the 80s and the 90s looking for mysticism, looking for the experience, and certainly the Buddhists and the Hindus have been blessed with a tremendous understanding of this quiet. God is with these people, and we have a tremendous amount to learn from them. and there's now dialogue between the Western monks, monks around here. Father Kevin Hunt is one of them, and the Buddhists, because we're sharing the same thing and we have the same vocabulary. They describe their mysticism just as John of the Cross describes this experience that he's giving the Western Church, and so we're very, very blessed to have had that interest in the Eastern religions and Buddhism and Hinduism, because you know that it isn't too long ago we called those folks pagans. We really and truly were dismissive of them, and we discarded their mysticism as totally off the wall. But now we know that there's a great deal of truth and beauty in their mystical tradition. But the folks that went over there and found it with the Orient, they didn't realize that we have a tradition here in the West, and John of the Cross is at the center of that the mystical tradition that we have. And to look into John of the Cross is I think a very important thing for us to do. I told somebody that we were going to have the John of the Cross was going to be the theme of this retreat, and they said, yeah, but we're not Carmelites. Well, that's snobbery. To be dismissive of our Carmelite brothers as if they were outside the church, and outside our pale of our snobbery, that's what we do though, isn't it? We judge people and everything according to what we think, but whatever it was that inspired you folks to look at John of the Cross, I think it was very, 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 a gift from the Spirit, because John of the Cross is a treasure in the Roman Church, and it's a treasure of our that we have, and what he is, his message is really very, very simple. Some people are frightened to death of him because they think that this nada, nada, nada is all moral pushing us to the nth of moral goodness and virtue that's beyond our capability and beyond anybody's range of accomplishment. But it's not that. That is not what he's talking about. He's talking about contemplation, and the contemplation is letting go of all that is material in the act of contemplation. That doesn't. He's not saying that you shouldn't have things, that you should be not Francis. It's not the Carmelites are not Franciscans. In the sense of Saint Francis, the Carmelites, and you might say obsessed with the reality of getting rid of things. It's desires that is the thread that holds a good many people's wings from taking off and flying. It's a wonderful, wonderful gift that the church has, and that's a wonderful thing that you folks are using St. John of the Cross as the theme for your retreat. So I hope you have a wonderful retreat and enjoy your study of John of the Cross, and because he is rich. And don't be afraid, and don't be turned away because of some of the harsh things that he's saying. They seem harsh, but he's talking about things in another reality, in the reality in connection with contemplation. To let us experience to have absolutely nothing going on in our spirit. Now remember the last conference that I gave, I talked about in our sleep, when there's no brain activity, then we are pure spirit. Well, I think that's the same thing that John of the Cross is trying to bring us to free us so that there's no brain activity, no desire, no memory at the particular moment of